My name is Nuwan. I work as an architect at WSO2. I work very closely with the WSO2 API manager team and looking into its research and development activities mainly. So today I'll be talking about cloud native API management. And before we get into the details, I'd like to spend a little bit of time trying to explain what cloud native really means. So most of us here, I'm pretty sure that we have already been on the cloud, right? So it's cloud is not a new thing. For at least half a decade, we know what it means, what it takes to be on the cloud, and we know how to run systems on the cloud. So why do we have to talk about cloud native today, and why is it becoming a really cool buzzword, and why is everybody talking about it today? So my understanding is that, so all this time, what we've really done by moving on into the cloud is that we've basically taken an on-premise code and shifted it onto the cloud and made it run on the cloud. So what we've basically done is, so if you had 10 VMs running on an on-premise data center, we basically rented some VMs with the same configuration perhaps on the cloud and basically migrated our code from our on-premise data center onto the cloud. And we've got it running successfully. So we basically cut down our hardware costs, the hardware purchasing costs, hardware maintenance costs, and we basically got our code running on the cloud successfully with better resiliency and distribution, right? And we've given better user experiences to our customers and all that. So that's good. But my question is, does it really reap the full potential, the full benefit of running on the cloud? The short answer to that question, I think, is no. Because what I think is, cloud is more about, not just about running your on-premise code on the cloud, but also about a lot about scalability, about granularity, about optimizing costs. So what that really means is, like, if you need a 10 VMs on your on-premise data center, do you really need that 10 VMs to be available all the time on the cloud? Perhaps you needed those 10 VMs to handle your peak load, but what about the average or the low load, right? Do you really need all those 10 VMs to be available on the cloud always? Perhaps not. Maybe you could survive with 7 and then scale up to 10 just when you need it, right? And also, with regard to your applications, do you need to scale out your entire application to handle that peak load? Or would it suffice to just scale that part that you need only to handle that peak load? Right? So cloud has been more of pay-as-you-go model, but what I think is it goes a little beyond further, and it's also about use what you really need. It's not just about pay for what you use, but also about use only what you really need, right? So our applications need to have this capability of being able to adapt into this new expectation, right? About the ability to scale independently, right? The ability to just consume the resources that it really wants according to the situation, right? So that's basically the benefit that we get from running our systems on the cloud. There's another angle to it, which is like what the early technology adapters, which is known as the FANG Club, for example. The FANG stands for Facebook, Amazon, Netflix, and Google. So these guys have really mastered the art of being able to push releases onto the cloud really fast and in a less risky manner as well. So Facebook, for example, does multiple releases, production releases a day onto its cloud. And it does that with zero downtime and very efficiently, right? So imagine the power that you can get if you could push your bug fixes, your new features, everything onto the cloud with zero downtime, with better resiliency, without having to wait for Big Bang releases to happen over months or weeks, but rather being able to push releases onto the cloud fast, right? So that's really the benefit of being cloud native, right? Those are the stuff that we have to look at in our applications, right? So modern enterprises are realizing this value of being cloud native, right? So we as an API management vendor, what we want to do is, like, when enterprises are ready or when they are in this process of moving on, we want to be ready for that process and help you to get there using API management principles and technologies. So we want our products to adapt to that expectation as well. So we'll look at what cloud native, some characteristics of being cloud native, right? So this is what I think are the most critical factors of becoming cloud native. One is becoming container friendly. So what does it really mean to become container friendly? So becoming container friendly basically means being able to boot up instantly with 1 second or 2 second latencies, right, at most, and immutable, right? For your software to be immutable and to be stateless as much as possible, to be able to scale granularly, right? So there's a bunch of different aspects when it comes to becoming container native, right? Then I talked about being able to adapt or rather scale independently. That's about being microservice friendly, right? So if your application is broken down into a couple of microservices, that gives you the ability to scale those parts of the application independently without having to worry or worry about the rest, right? So being microservices friendly is about that level of granularity of the application that we are talking about. Then DevOps is also something that we have to now think about from the application design stages itself, right? Being able to configure your full application using environment variables, being able to release them fast, right? Making them immutable, etc. Then continuous integration and continuous deployment. So we talked about Facebook doing multiple releases to the cloud on a given day. Right, so that's because the applications, the nature of the applications, the architecture supports and nurtures that model within the application itself. Right, so immutability and container friendliness is also some characteristics we have to look at when we are thinking about CI/CD aspects of our applications. So there's a bunch of these things that you can read about on the internet when we are talking about these characteristics of cloud native applications. So going on into API management, we are in a phase of rethinking and redesigning our API management offering to suit this criteria, right? So we are basically, instead of hacking up the existing software, what we are trying to do is to rethink at this problem and try to design a product to suit this in a much better, faster, and a cheaper way. So what we've basically done is basically we've taken the main components of the product and grouped them into sets of microservices. So each of these boxes that you see in different colors are groups of microservices. The API Manager Core is a set of microservices that basically exposes the core product functionality, from API design to publishing to development to the developer portal, application subscription, all of that stuff is grouped into a set of microservices, and that we name as the API core. Then comes the API gateway, which is basically the proxy that sits along your microservices and gives you security rate limiting and all those aspects of a gateway. That again is being redesigned from scratch to suit the microservices world. Key management, again, is a set of microservices which basically exposes the security aspects of API management, such as the OAuth services, the SCIM, the user provisioning services, the OpenID Connect services. All of that stuff is being grouped into a set of microservices into a component called Key Manager. Traffic Manager is basically the component that does rate limiting. Right, all the services related to rate limiting are grouped and exposed as a separate component. And the same concept applies to analytics as well. The real-time analytics, the batch analytics, all those are grouped into a separate collection of microservices and hosted in a different separate runtime. Right, so we'll look a bit at the API core and the API gateway. So the API core is basically a set of services secured using OAuth 2. So we have a product, a REST API layer, which basically exposes all of the product functionalities. Like I said, from API design to application development, and all the CI/CD aspects are all exposed as services using a REST API, which is secured using OAuth 2. And then we have the traditional business logic layer and the persistence layer, all in the same set of microservices. And another interesting fact is that we also have an embedded message broker. So when we are talking about a microservices world, it's important that we keep the communication between these different components in a loosely coupled way, right? So we don't directly access those services because we might not know where they exist even. So there is a need for a pub/sub model within the product to be able to communicate with different components. And for that, what we've done is basically we've developed an embeddable message broker component and burned it in to the API core. And we'll talk a little bit about the API gateway. The speciality about the API gateway is that it's being rewritten in Ballerina. So I'll talk about why the Y factor in a later slide. So the API gateway, again, like I said, is a collection of microservices offering security, rate limiting, threat protection policies, analytics, and also message mediation and routing. So all using the Ballerina programming language. So earlier, we used to have like the normal Synapse-based API gateway. So we are in the process of like changing this to be based on Ballerina. Why, I'll explain later. So in the world, in the microservices world, the gateway is actually just another composite microservice. So you have different technologies for writing atomic microservices, right? So you have my WSO2's MSFOJ, you have Spring Boot, Drop Wizard, and a bunch of other technologies for writing atomic microservices. So when you want to expose these atomic microservices as APIs, that's where the gateway comes into the picture. So what the gateway really means is that then it is a composite microservice which basically does a composition among several other atomic microservices and exposes them in a secured, rate limited, and a monitored fashion, right? So that's the role of the API gateway in a microservices world, in short. So why we are writing the API gateway in Ballerina is for that primary reason. Because Ballerina is a fantastic programming language for writing composite microservices. All the other technologies for writing microservices are focused on atomic microservices, whereas Ballerina has a really big edge when it comes to writing composite microservices. So that's the main reason of choosing Ballerina for this technology. And when it comes to the API development world, what this really means for an API developer who's basically composing a set of microservices to be exposed as an API is that on the API development front, what the API developer will be doing is basically drawing a sequence diagram. So he will be what he'll be doing as a developer is that he'll be like composing a sequence diagram of the combining the microservices that he's interested in composing and exposing them as a secured API. So that's basically the development experience for an API developer when using Ballerina as a gateway technology. Then let's talk a little bit about scaling the API gateway. So we talked about being able to scale up and down dynamically, right? So when you think of an API deployment process, so far what we've been doing basically is push an API artifact from the API publisher or the API development portal onto the gateways. So that has a set of limitations when you look at it from a scalability angle. So we are basically moving this model to a push, to a pull model from a push model. So what that really means is that when a product UI or some external client pushes an API onto the API core, what it basically does is that it puts that notification into that embedded message broker. The gateways that are out there, which are connected to the broker and listening to notifications, will receive this update, and all the gateways will then go and pull that API artifact from the API core. So that way, we get a lot more scaling capability of the API gateway when you compare it with a push model. And when it comes to scaling, it's also important to partition, right? Otherwise, you end up deploying all the APIs on all the gateways, which might not be what you want exactly. So for that, we've come up with a labeling solution. So what that really means is that each gateway that you have running in your system, you can label it using a name of your choice. So maybe you have your APIs deployed in several regions of the world, such as the US, Europe, Sydney, etc. So what you can basically do is have your gateways located regionally, and when you deploy your APIs, you basically label them same where you want them to run. So when the gateways come and pull that artifact from the API core, it will only get the APIs that it matches the labels of the particular API gateway. So this way, you get the ability to run hybrid deployments where you could probably run your gateways on the cloud and your management on-premise, and where you could run your labels in different regions, etc. So you could consume this in a manner that suits your business the most. We are also thinking about a micro gateway concept. So the difference between a traditional gateway and a micro gateway is that a micro gateway should be able to execute on a lockdown environment. The current architecture of the gateway is such that when it gets a token, it has to basically contact the key manager to validate that token, contact the analytics server, contact the rate limiting server to do rate limiting and all that stuff. The concept of the micro gateway is that it is able to perform all this functionality within itself. The idea behind this is that the gateway at startup will bootstrap itself with all the necessary information it needs to perform this functionality. Right? So it will have all the API keys that it needs to perform security, the rate limiting policies, and the ability to log analytics data within itself. So at boot time, it will either contact the API core to get all this information or get it from the runtime itself. And when it gets a token to validate, it basically doesn't have to contact anyone else to validate it. It has all that information inside. So this is an immutable runtime. So if there are any changes or updates to the artifacts, you basically have to respawn a new instance of the micro gateway. Then it's also important to think about service discovery. Because in a microservices world, you may not really know where your services are deployed. So from an API development point of view, and also from an API runtime point of view, it's important to have service discovery capabilities. So especially if your services are hosted on a cluster management system, such as OpenShift, for example, the API developers might not really know the exact endpoint of the service that they want to contact to. So they need to have capabilities to search and discover the available endpoints. So what we are thinking of is providing a capability for the API developer to be able to search and discover APIs endpoints available in the cluster. And also, the same capability is required at the runtime level. So maybe what you just have is a static URL, which might dynamically route to any different IP at the runtime. So the dynamic discovery capability is also important at the runtime level, which is the API gateway in this case. So we are thinking about introducing service discovery capabilities for the API developer and at the API gateway as well. And talking about scalability, private jet mode is another key factor, another killer feature of being able to run APIs or rather scale APIs, especially when you're operating on a cluster management system, such as OpenShift, Mesos, Cloud Foundry, etc. So this is about spawning a container per API. So the API product manager gets the power, the ability, to actually spawn a separate runtime for his API and scale it out independently. So from an API publisher point of view, from API developer point of view, the product manager can say, run this particular API in a dedicated gateway container, right? So that's the idea behind the private jet mode, where you get the capability of spawning up one or many gateways to run your API only. So that gives you immense scaling capability and also a bunch of other benefits, such as your API's performance does not impact the other API's performance, and you could do upgrades to that particular environment only without affecting your other environments, and a whole bunch of possibilities. And we are also thinking about stateless UIs moving forward. So the reason behind stateless UIs is basically to get rid of the overhead of having to replicate state among a cluster of services. So if your first request goes to one container, and if your second request goes to another container, and if your system is based on state, then you have to deal with the problem of replicating this state. So what we're moving on is, for the product UI, is moving on into a stateless UI, where the state is actually held in a token. So your UI basically gets a token at login, and that token can be validated at any different runtime. So if your first request goes to server 1 and the second request goes to server 2, that's not a problem, because as long as your token is valid, your UI session is valid. So this is basically the architecture of the UI. I won't go through it in detail, but what I need to highlight is that at login, you get a token from the OAuth server, which basically gives you capability for the UI to access all the services it needs at the API core. Then we are moving on into multi-tenancy. So the current multi-tenancy mode is such that it's a shared multi-tenancy model. Whereas on the same JVM, you have multiple tenants executing their code on the same JVM. So this basically limits the scalability concerns, aspects rather. So what we are really moving on is into an isolated multi-tenancy model. So what that basically means is that each tenant gets its own runtime now, right? So one tenant's APIs or the runtime, the performance of one tenant does not impact the other tenant, and you get like independent scalability of your tenants. So that's basically our thought process on addressing the multi-tenancy concerns when it comes to a microservices or cloud-native world. And finally, talking about deployment automation. So we talked about being able to do like releases very rapidly and all of that. So what we are basically working on is a DevOps tooling set. So one of them includes a CLI, which is basically primarily for doing API import and export. So the CLI that we're designing is actually intelligent enough to know about the various environments that you have in your system, such as your dev, QA, and prod environment. So what you can do is basically say, pull an API from my dev environment and push it into my QA environment. So this tooling that is something that we are designing that can be integrated into your Jenkins pipeline and other deployment automation tools that you have in your system. So this is our thought process on our next major iteration of the API management product. So the architecture behind this product can be found in this documentation. And the carbon repo, what I have mentioned here, is basically where the code base of the product is. So we welcome your thoughts and your contributions into this, into getting our next version of the product like really cloud native. We're also running the current version, which is API management 2.x, is also going on iteratively with new features and new releases. So this is something that we've started to do. So we really welcome your feedback and your contributions to this. We've currently done about 7 milestones of the next version while we are actively maintaining the current, the 2.x version as well. And the third is the product repo, which basically combines the components that are in the carbon repo. You'll basically understand more about it when you go and go through the readmes and stuff of this. So we really welcome your contributions and thoughts and ideas on this. So that brings me to the end of this session. I hope it has been fruitful. So yes, since we're almost at time, I'll introduce to you the next speaker of our track.